Okay, well, listen, what I'm going to give you is kind of our standard assure pitch. The Alliance for System Safety of UAS through Research Excellence. So that's the long term. The short term, the one that's easier to remember, is we're the FAA's unmanned center of excellence. We're the folks that are kind of the hub between academia, industry, and the federal government. FAA mainly, but we also do work for DOD, NASA, Department of Homeland Security, you name it. We've been around for about 6 years, believe it or not, working this program. We've been a formal team for about 3 years, and back in May, well, about this time last year, we won a competition that went on for about 18 months and selected us as the FAA's new Center of Excellence for UAS Operations. It's a very, very large team. We've got 15 core schools. We've got 7 affiliates. We're about to go to 8. Hopefully, we're going to be able to add the Technion, the MIT in Israel onto us. About 100-plus corporate entities, and it's all led by us at Mississippi State University. I lead that of our Stennis Space Center campus, which is, if you let me drive, about 40 minutes from the French Quarter there on the Gulf Coast. So, first basic question, what is a center of excellence? If you've been hanging around the FAA for any length of time, you'll know that COEs are actually a fairly old concept in the FAA. They've been around for about 15 years or so. It's a congressionally mandated program. And the idea is to give the FAA the capacity to have academic backbench backup in those subjects that normal universities are just not going to go into on their own. So air traffic control analysis, runway coefficient analysis, or in this case, manned systems. The reason that they're so attractive is that you get two things that are like solid gold for academia out of it. Number one, you get a cooperative agreement with the FAA, and each one of our schools gets its own separately negotiated cooperative agreement, which makes it dead easy for the FAA to turn to Mississippi State University or every real aeronautical university and get them working on research. And then we're still working on it. We also get our own IDIQ contract in determinant quantity and determinant delivery contract with the FAA that allows them to flow money to us very simply with this right and quick statement of work it gets down to us. As I've learned now that I've been out in the industry now for about 3 years from the Air Force, that's about a 2-year process to get one of those done if you come in otherwise. So, huge thing. We get 2 funding vehicles out of it. We get grants, and we've been pulling in about $5 million a year. Hopefully, we're going to get $10 million next year for grants. Good news, bad news on grants. Number one, they're free money from the federal government. Number two, we have to match them one for one. So for every dollar we get in grant, we've got to go out to the industry and get another dollar or pay for it out of our own pockets. And then I already mentioned the IDIQ contract, which is separate, and that's task dependent. So, for example, those of you know Dallas Brooks, he's the director of Erasmus Flight Track Lab at Mississippi State University. He's also on the SART board. He gets paid through a direct contract. All right. Now, I know we're behind. I'm not going to tell you everything about every school on here because that would take an hour, but these are the assured schools. We put our team together 6 years ago. We went after two things and two things only. We wanted schools with the most practical, applied research experience with unmanned systems. We knocked that ball out of the park. And then we wanted schools that knew the FAA and aviation rulemaking inside and out. We pretty much knocked that ball out of the park. So without going into too much details about the schools, I'll just cover broadly. We have the entire state of Kansas. We have Wichita State University, Kansas University, and Kansas State University. Why Kansas? You cannot find finer schools on the face of this earth when it comes to particularly airworthiness in the FAA. FAA's airworthiness center is in Kansas City. It's easier to name an aircraft manufacturer that is not Kansas than it is to make one that is, because they're all there. We've got New Mexico State University, a fantastic UAS program. They were the original UAS test site for the FAA. We've got one of their former test site directors here. They've been doing this, gosh, in business about 12 years, I think, if I counted it up right, a long time there. University of North Dakota, key to the Northern Plains test site. He's got a lot of practical experience, particularly doing detect and avoid work. We've got University of Alabama in Huntsville, tremendous amount of work in UAS. He's got one of the nation's only rotorcraft science centers. Works hand in glove with the Army's program manager for UAS, which is about 5 miles out of their front door. We have the Godzilla and Shadow Government for Aviation Education in the World at Maryville Aeronautical University. They're in 13 different countries around the earth. We also have North Carolina State University, which has been deputized by the governor to lead all UAS operations in the state of North Carolina. Of course, we've got Mississippi State University represented by myself, Dallas Brooks, who runs the Rasmus Flight Lab. We've incubated two UAS companies already, Israeli Aircraft Industries, Aurora Flight Sciences, have their manufacturing facilities at Starkville, Mississippi, because of Mississippi State. We've got a couple of foreign universities, University of Southampton in the United Kingdom, Concordia University in Canada, and hopefully we'll be adding the Technion in Israel very soon. We are run by an executive board. And the executive board is divided up into those research focus areas that we think the FAA is going to have to master in order to quickly and efficiently and safely integrate UAS into the national airspace. So first and foremost, we have airworthiness, which is led by Tom Alday at Wichita State University. It's led by Dallas Brooks at Mississippi State University. When we say airworthiness, we mean everything that traditionally encompasses airworthiness, plus our major research thrust, at least the past year, which is dealing with air-to-air and air-to-ground collisions. Training is led by Kurt Caraway, C. Caraway at Kansas State University. I'll have to admit that one has been a little bit more of a challenge working with the FAA on it, because the Part 107 rules, we're still talking about what's going to come out on that. We've not gotten any asking to go for the above 55-pound UAS, so we're doing quite a bit of work there. The assured word for air traffic control, air traffic management, is air traffic integration. That's run by Richard Stansbury at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. As you can imagine, UAS are going to have a massive impact on air traffic control system in the United States. And we picked Embry-Riddle to do that because they host the FAA's next-gen test bed down there at Daytona Beach. C2 and Spectrum, probably the hardest part of Assure, which is control and communication, led by Kyle Snyder at North Carolina State University, backed up by Jim Bradbury at the Ohio State University. Control and communication is always the toughest parts about UAS. When I was the senior intelligence officer in the Air Force, I would always have guys coming in wanting to argue about the air vehicle, something to do with the, you know, whether the Russians would see it or stuff like that, and I always kick them out and tell them, come back in and put your t-shirt on. And the t-shirt I want you to have is, it's the data links, stupid. Because really everything about UAS boils down to how you talk to the aircraft and how much autonomy you give that aircraft. And that is a tough, tough problem to solve, particularly the spectrum side. In the Air Force, we had used to use the maximum amount of spectrum available for the DoD. You guys don't have that luxury. It's a tough problem. Human factors is run by Drexel University. I thought this was going to be the easy one. Turns out there's been very little research done on unmanned systems, human factors, and they are radically different from manned aircraft factors. There's a lot more to it than coming up with that T formation for your T instruments and making sure that the gear handle looks like a wheel when you go to put it down. When you've got the ability to hook up to the internet and you've got essentially either unlimited air wall space to put a bunch of monitors on, like we do for the Predator, or very limited space, something that you can hold on your hand at some field out of Kansas, human factors becomes pretty tough. Detect and avoid is one that everybody always talks about. We've got two of the best schools in the business working it. Generally, University of North Dakota does airborne detect and avoid, and New Mexico State does ground-based detect and avoid. Our vice director is Marty Rogers, University of Alaska Fairbanks. He's probably our most experienced UAS airman. We're going to be setting up a Assure International Research Council. That's to coordinate UAS research, not UAS rules, across the countries that belong to Assure, which right now is Canada, the United Kingdom, we're hoping soon to be Israel. We get along best with the Canadians, and if you're familiar with Transport Canada, they've got a great way to thaw through. As close as we are with the Canadian government on this, our rules will never be the same, but one thing that we can both draw upon is the same research. So we're hoping to find ways that we can share that across countries. What we're most proud about is the 108, I think, on this slide, External Advisory Board members. These are our corporate members. There's a smattering of federal and state agencies up there as well. We've got somebody from everybody's function. Patrick is checking. Check it.
Patrick Egan, I haven't seen him up there.
I've seen somebody. Probably hit under one of the dots there. I think it's a bright red dot. We'll find it. The font is purposely small. I can't read it either, so don't join that quote. Corporate membership is vital for Assure. First and foremost, we've got that monkey on our back. We've got to match our funding one for one. Unlike a lot of areas in quote-unquote conventional aerospace research, we're not dealing with two airline manufacturers, a couple dozen or so airlines, and then a dozen or so cats and dogs stuff out there. We're not dealing with a very firmly established area of aviation research or law. We're dealing with something where you ask a simple question in the UAS realm and you collect 200 people from 200 different companies and they want to reach out and give you an answer to that. So it's very, very vital to us. But we're a small, dedicated group and we don't have time to work with folks that aren't willing to put their nose to the grindstone, put some skin in the game, and engage in cooperative research with us in the FAA. So we've got, we want to be really clear about this. We get a lot of folks calling us up, asking us for money to do this and that. Assure is not a money maker. We want to channel Mitt Romney, and I hate doing this late in the election, but we are takers, we're not makers. You're not going to make money off of Assure now. We're hoping that if we can supply the research to the FAA to write the rules, that you're going to make money off of us later when you can get flying more safely and quicker based on research that we're going to. We have to either we'll take the corporate IRAD, actual money, or assistance in kind. I want to personally thank a couple of our partners there in the back. Drone Compliance, not Compiler, which I've been practicing not saying for a while. For example, they're going to end up giving us about $500,000 a year assistance in kind by allowing us to use software licenses for their fantastic software out there. While I'm at it, I'm also going to apologize to Doug Marshall up here. There was about 2 weeks ago, I was calling ASTM and ASTW for a week, and those of you that know, Paul McDuffie with Institute for about 24 hours last week. I was calling him Patrick McDuffie, so I got your name right, so there we go. What we do is we used to go through this kabuki dance, making sure that you could provide us with so much in money on such a specific thing. It was taking us months to negotiate joining Assure. We're going to go with a simple joining fee now. It'll be a few $1,000s per year. Should make it a lot easier. Going. The only other requirements we have is we ask that you attend one Assure meeting a year, and I'll explain where those are. We'll be able to cover travel for that. We make it easier for you. And again, we're there to turn research into rules. We're not there to fund your research program, but we do hope you make money on us in the back end. Two meetings we got, the Monday before Exponential in New Orleans. We'll always have our yearly meetings the Monday before Exponential in New Orleans, maybe the day after. The other one is New Mexico State University's TAC conference, which I've forgotten what TAC stands for, but it'll be 5th of December in Santa Fe, New Mexico this year. Next thing I want to talk about are our AIR teams, the Assure Industry Research teams. These are teams that we're forming now, and we form them with a specific set of industry partners and a specific set of Assure partners for a specific reason. And we exist to help both the FAA, and in this case, mainly the standard-setting organizations like ASTM and RTCA, We think it's just to help them make rules by providing them the research. So the one I'll pick apart is the one that we're hoping to get set up very soon, Micro Air, which is going to cover the recent micro UAS rules, and more importantly, the operations of people. So we're going to go to the companies that are most interested in accelerating that research. And if you've read the ARC report, basically what the ARC said is the FAA should allow the industry to set up industry consensus standards for both micro UAS and for operations over people, and then allow the industry to self-certify compliance with that, which sounds great, but as Doug Marshall just mentioned, you have to actually put the standards out, you have to come up with validation methods. If you do it the old-fashioned way, Doug was talking about how when it actually comes to providing the research, there's usually a pregnant pause, you hear crickets because there's no formal organization set up to do that. Correlation of the willing. This case, we're going to set up University of Alabama Huntsville, who's doing our ground collision research. They're going to get companies that are willing to do that. We're going to sign an NDA. We're going to agree on the intellectual property with the provision that most of the work that we're going to do, if not all, is going to become public. And we're going to be there for Doug when he needs research to set these standards up. Hopefully, we can accelerate that quite a bit. We're also setting up what we call low-altitude safety hubs. We'll do most of our basic research at the test sites and the labs and on the computers. When it comes time to test in the real world, we want to test them in really specific, realistic scenarios. So we'll have a hub set up in Mississippi State and other places to do precision agriculture, not to actually do precision agriculture, but to see if the beyond visual line of sight mitigation measures that New Mexico State University has come up and the FAA thinks are about right, do they work in the real world? Do they work out in the Mississippi Delta when you've got crop dusters buzzing all over the place? The same with the other ones, wildfire response hub. I know we had some firefighters talking about out here. How do you do that in the real world? How do you gather research from doing that? This is the research that we're doing now. We've got 8 funded tasks, about $10 million worth of research. We're hoping to get our next $10 million of research released to us in the next month or so. First thing we're doing, Doug talked about ASTM F3803, airworthiness standards. We didn't write the standards, Doug wrote the standards, we're validating them for the FAA to make sure it works, that's going great. We're also developing a kind of a menu of a beyond visual line of sight safety mitigation measures at New Mexico State and University of North Dakota. They're going to come up and give the FAA an idea about whether ground-based sensing avoid is a safe methodology for flying down visual line of sight, whether ADS-B is a good idea, whether something we haven't thought of is a good idea. Great place for industry to participate with us. Air-to-air collision is the one that gets the most attention. I was actually sort of insulted when this thing came up that they were going to make us do what I thought was going to be the 50th air-to-air collision study. No one has really done an air-to-air collision study. So Wichita State, along with Montana State, Mississippi State, University of Alabama, Huntsville, and Montana State University have already started crashing computer drones into a computer narrow body transport and a Learjet thing. We're going to be doing component testing where we're going to be shooting specific parts of UAS, engines and batteries, into aluminum, and then we're hoping next year we'll actually do it against actual airframes, leading engines and cockpits. We're going to expand that next year to general aviation, some type of Cessna aircraft and helicopters. The other one that gets me a phone call today is engine ingest. No one has done a drone engine ingest study that will meet scientific standards. Ohio State University and our great partner, GE Aviation, are going to do that. We don't have the money to do an actual ingest, but we're hopefully going to do an actual one next year. Air-to-ground collision, Dave Arterburn, University of Alabama Huntsville, was the hero of MicroArc. We just completed our literature research and done some preliminary research, and we were able to tell the ARC that 250 grams for a UAS was a reasonably safe weight to allow no airworthiness standards for. And it's looking, we're not ready to come out with this publicly, but it's looking like we can get away with a lot more weight than we thought, depending on the design of the UAS and operations over people. Maintenance standards, Kansas State is working that. A lot of work to be done on that. Surveillance criticality, can we use ADS-B and TCAS on drones, or do we need to invent something else? human factors, pioneering work on what a display should look like for the ideal UAS display, and then how we do the training. And we're also, for some reason, somewhat inexplicably doing visual observers at New Mexico State. Why should you come to a shore? The simplest argument is the FAA is not going to be doing any more pathfinders, so if you want to work with the FAA, you got to come to a shore in order to do industry research, and we will welcome you to do that. The other answer is if you pool your resources, you work with us, we've got federal money, you've got corporate money, if we get just five companies to pool their resources, you will be able to get those results to the FAA and find hopefully faster at 20% the cost that you normally do it. We're core to three FAA test sites. We've actually done the math. We have more drones than the United States Air Force. No one flies more yearly in the United States other than Assure. We've got quite a few hours, and we're on 14 different FAA and international rulemaking committees. And that is my story, and I'm sticking to it, and we're open for questions. Or not.
We know we have time, so let's just do one question.
All right, one question.